Our next speaker is Jill Kalai from the FERSE School of Computer Science and also the Einstein Institute of Mathematics at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. Jill has always been putting quantum computation under the microscope, the scrutiny of the microscope. And it is actually heartwarming to have somebody who sits on the other side of the fence sometimes and look critically at what quantum, the hype on quantum computing. And so today he's going to talk about various aspects of the noisy intermediate scale quantum computers, and which is currently what a lot of people are pushing for. But I think Joe has his own perspective, and let us hear from him. Joe, as soon as you are ready, Bill?
Yeah, sure. As you're ready,
just go ahead.
So thank you very much for this lovely introduction and for inviting
me. Thank you for coming.
Yeah, so I should say that I would be quite happy to visit again Singapore. I was, we met, I think, 3 years ago. Certainly, there are many impressive things in the city, the country, and this is just one picture that I took of a very lovely sculpture. I think it's well known, which on the one hand showed a unique approach of encouraging art in Singapore, and yet the topic is very universal, and I can compare it to two pictures. One that I took on the bottom right in Akko a few years ago, and another one by a famous photographer, Sarah Eyal, who took it also in Akko maybe a few decades ago. So this children playing is a sort of a theme which is universal, and I hope also everything will go back to normal and
and we can welcome you to Singapore.
Yes, so let me start by mentioning two background questions, which the first is, are quantum computers possible? And this is a vastly important question. There are huge expectations, very large investments, huge implications and consequences. This is a clear-cut major scientific question. Another question that I want to mention is about the recent demonstration about a year and a half ago. Is the Google demonstration of quantum supremacy valid? And this is also a very important question. This event, Google claims, was compared to the Wright flyer in 1903, to the Enrico Fermi's nuclear chain reaction in 1942, to the first vacuum tube digital computer in 1945, and to the recent discovery of the Higgs boson. So this was claimed to be a very major event. And in this talk, although we'll have these two questions in the background, I will talk about a variety of computational, mathematical, and statistical questions, concepts, and ideas related to the study of these two questions. So we will not always go after the most significant bit. We will sometimes look at a small part of the picture. And I should add to the second question that we can add the recent boson sampling experiment. Is it also valid, which was claimed to be an independent verification of, in some sense, of the Google claims. Okay, so let me, I'm sure that for most of you this is not needed, but let me just remind you that NISQ computers, or noisy intermediate scale quantum computers, are simply noisy quantum circuits with at most a few hundred qubits, many industrial companies and academic group are trying to build noisy NISQ computers and other NISQ systems. And let me say that a qualitative difference between the NISQ regime, the intermediate scale regime, and larger scale regime is that in the NISQ regime, a single error causes the circuit to fail. This is a fairly, you know, general statement. There are several caveats. For some systems, a single error causes it to fail. In some other systems, you still have some correlation with the desired target. But this is largely correct. And when you go to the larger regime, there is the possibility of a quantum fault tolerance and error correction, which allow you to tolerate a large number of qubits. So again, since this is one of our two main questions, I should mention the Google experiment. So this was a nice demonstration of many areas, computational complexity, physics, statistics, engineering, and the massive computation on supercomputers. And the experiment is about a random quantum circuit that produced a sample of few million 0-1 vectors of length 53, which this sample is based on certain ideal probability distribution. And the claim is based on the main claim is based on two subclaims. The first is that the estimator for the fidelity of how well the distribution is doing satisfies that it's larger than 1/1,000. And the second is that producing a sample with similar statistical property is beyond reach for current supercomputers. And let me, before I move to the whole talk, let me quickly tell you my answer to the two questions. And the very brief answer is no, is negative to both questions, and slightly in more detail, are quantum computers possible? So in my view, it is a serious possibility that quantum computers are not possible. And this is what I expect and study for quite a few years now. And is the Google demonstration of quantum supremacy valid? So the Google claims are not convincing. There are serious concerns regarding their experiment. And this also applies to the recent claims based on photonic systems that I will mention in a minute. So just to summarize my view, here is a cartoon from 2017 where to the question, what about the efforts of Google, IBM, Microsoft, Intel, Alibaba, Rigetti, D-Wave, Quantum Circuit, IonQ, NIST, Atos, and so on and so forth, both in academia and in industry, to reach very stable qubits and demonstrate quantum supremacy? The answer is they will all fail. And there is even a footnote by this flying elephant that we shouldn't expect false positive for high quality encoded qubits. For quantum supremacy, we might expect false positive, and indeed this is what we witnessed in my view. Okay, so my lecture today will consist of 10 snapshots. For more, I refer you to these papers. Some of them are fairly recent. Part of the talk, statistical part, is a work I did with Yosi Rinott and Tomer Shoham on statistical aspects of the quantum supremacy demonstration. And another work which is crucial to boson sampling, but also to my general approach, is a paper with Guy Kindler on Gaussian noise sensitivity and boson sampling. So, let me just make two updates. I will try to adopt the terminology HQCA which is acronym for huge quantum computational advantage instead of quantum supremacy. First of all, also the new photonic experiment, they use the term quantum advantage. I think quantum supremacy is problematic both because of the connotation of the word supremacy, but also because supremacy usually means you are superior across the board, like the supremacy of the king. And in the case of quantum computers, we see very targeted and pointed advantages. But I also agree that the word advantage alone is too weak. And therefore, I propose huge quantum advantage and this acronym. So I'll try to use this. And again, another update in December 2020. So about a month ago, a group of researchers mainly from USTC in Hefei announced a huge quantum computational advantage for samples produced by photonic system implementing Gaussian boson sampling. And I will, this is another interesting development that I will briefly also mention. So let me start with the big picture, and I will tell you very briefly the argument against quantum computers. So very briefly, it goes as follows. Noisy intermediate scale quantum systems, or NISQ systems, represent a low level computational ability that will not allow using them for demonstrating HQCA, quantum supremacy, or for building quantum error correcting codes that are needed for quantum computation. So this is the, in one sentence, the argument. And let me divide it to two claims. The first claim is that NISQ devices cannot achieve HQCA. The second claim is that the noise level or the engineering effort required for good quality quantum error correction is lower than that required for HQCA. So the noise level is lower, the engineering effort is higher. The second claim tells you that quantum error correction of the required quality is harder than achieving HQCA. And if you accept both claims, claim A and claim B, then good quality quantum error correction for NISQ systems is beyond reach. And I should mention that those claims on their own, many people in the quantum computing community accept or even both these claims, but don't realize the consequence of both of them being correct. So there are many researchers who think that to demonstrate a quantum supremacy or HQCA, we need to wait for quantum error correction and quantum tolerance. This is a common view. Regarding the second claim, I think there is a lot of evidence, both theoretical, but mainly experimental, that to build quantum error correction, even say something as simple as distance 5 surface code, or even distance 3 surface code, requires, it's harder, requires lower level of noise compared to the building of HQCA. Okay. So another way to put this argument is to describe four numbers. Alpha is the rate of noise required by large quantum computers, so the rate of noise which will allow you a fault tolerance a quantum computation. So this is the topic of the famous threshold theorem, if you wish. beta is the rate of noise required for good quality quantum error correct or correcting code. So for example, distance 5 surface code, if we want to fix our notation, gamma is the rate of noise required to demonstrate HQCA, and delta is the lowest realistic rate of noise. And the argument is based on the claims that the alpha is smaller than beta, which is smaller than gamma, which is smaller than delta. And again, I think the main theoretic claim is that beta is smaller than gamma, that gamma is smaller than delta. And I think that many people, I said that the two claims that I mentioned are accepted by many people, but many people also believe in another claim that in principle, we can push the rate of noise to zero. So it's a common belief that delta is zero. Of course, this belief is not consistent with the other two claims, but there is a strong intuition among people that the noise can be pushed by enough effort as low as possible. And indeed, one of the consequences of this argument is that this belief is incorrect. There is a lowest realistic rate of noise. I should say that these constants, alpha, beta, gamma, and delta, are not universal constants. They slightly depend on the setting, on the architecture, but they are fairly robust, and the inequalities between them are, in my view, also very robust. So I should mention the importance of HQCA or quantum supremacy for this theoretic understanding. So I'm not aware of a conceptual explanation for why quantum error correction and quantum fault tolerance are not possible. And I tried to find such a conceptual explanation from 2005 to 2013. So for 8 years, this was my direction of research. And there, for these years, my main effort was to understand the notion of error correlations and to see how can we impose can we find a model of noise with error correlation that will make the threshold theorem the assertion of the threshold theorem will be no longer correct. And I think that error correlation is part of the picture, but this is not the explanation. The main issue is the error rate. And this was, I think, a very interesting line of research. And I think in hindsight, this research, what it gives a lot of consequences that goes in the other direction. If you accept that you cannot build a fault tolerance quantum computation, then this gives you a lot of information about a noisy quantum computer systems and about error correlation. And the notion of HQCA or quantum supremacy, and mainly not only the notion itself, the bold proposal to implement HQCA without quantum fault tolerance changed matters. And once this bold proposal was put forward, then we could analyze the situation and realize that there is a simple conceptual reason based on computational complexity for why HQCA or quantum supremacy is unattainable for NISQ system. I should add that if you cannot build quantum error correction by NISQ systems, this does not formally close all the roads to quantum computers, because there are some attempts, or most notably a topological quantum computer, that try to go directly to to the very stable qubits, not through NISQ system, not through noisy intermediate scale quantum systems. And but the argument does extend, and also it's very reasonable that the fate of these parallel approaches to quantum computation will be the same. There are some ways to extend the argument also to topological quantum computing. Okay, so this is one idea I wanted to mention. And I want to mention another piece of mathematics, which is quite relevant to my study. And so here I'll be a bit more technical. And I will, and so let's consider a probability distribution on 0-1 strings of length n. And we can write the distribution in terms of what's called the Fourier-Walsh function that are denoted here by WS of X. So the P of X is described as the sum of P hat of S, WS of X. And this allows us to study various noise models. I should mention that the basic noise model in the Google study that I will mention in a minute is the following. The noisy distribution has the same Fourier-Walsh coefficient for the empty set, and all the other Fourier-Walsh coefficients are shrink by the same factor phi, which is the fidelity. And I'm sorry, it's written here theta instead of phi, but this is a type. And I should mention a more realistic noise model, which is mathematically can be regarded as the heat kernel noise. And in this model, the high degree Fourier-Walsh coefficient are reduced exponentially. So n hat of s, this is the Fourier distribution of the noisy distribution, it's some t to the power of the size of s times the Fourier coefficient of the ideal distribution. So the Fourier description seems a valuable tool to understanding probability distribution coming from NISQ systems. And I should mention that this study was initiated in my 2014 paper, a work with Guy Kindler on noisy boson sampling. And it's related to my 1999 work with Benjamini and with Itai Benjamini and Oded Shram on noise stability and noise sensitivity, which had a completely different motivation, but the motivation there was studying a model in statistical mechanics and combinatorics called percolation. And a related statistical notion, which is very interesting, is called the ANOVA decomposition. And right now, in the context of understanding statistics of NISQ systems, we try to develop statistical tools to understand Fourier behavior of distribution based on very sparse samples. So I mentioned that here are three heroes of the Fourier analysis or relevant Fourier analysis. This is Joseph Fourier. And you can see also Joseph Walsh and Charles Hermite. Okay, so I just want to tell you that the PowerPoint proposed to me to have this new setting for this slide. So I just show it to you this feature, but. Okay, so the study of noise sensitivity and stability. So this is something, so these are the people I mentioned. Here I'm with Oded Shram and Itai Benyamini, and here is Guy Kindler in the picture. And here is a book about noise sensitivity of Boolean function and percolation, which deals with this topic. Okay, let me move to the third snapshot. And this is the behavior of NISQ sample. So we have probability samples using noise intermediate scale quantum computers. And the Fourier study, mainly from the paper with Kindler, tells you two major insights about NISQ systems. And the first insight is that for a constant noise level, the computational power of NISQ systems is very limited. So here there is some subtle issue, because when I talk about NISQ systems, I talk about intermediate scale. And when I talk about computational power, I talk about asymptotic behavior. So in this lecture, I will not explain the connection, but this is a very important connection. But bear with me having in mind this caveat. And here is the picture. On the left, we see the computational world, or some of the main complexity classes. We see the circle P. This corresponds to polynomial time algorithms. And this is what we usually regard as what classical computation can do. We also see the ellipse of Q, which represents the power of quantum computers. I use the word Q. There are some technical names, but they refer to specific algorithmic tasks. So BQP refers to decision problem, and we are mainly talking about sampling problem. So I just use Q to discuss the computational power of a quantum computer in general. And you can also see the class NP, the famous class NP. We all know the conjecture that NP is not equal to P. And here, slightly bigger than the NP in the picture, but much bigger in reality. The picture is out of scale. We see the entire polynomial hierarchy, PH. And what's interesting about the power of quantum computers is that they include, of course, the power of classical computer. They don't include the full class NP, so general NP problems cannot be solved by a quantum computer. But on the other hand, they reach out of the polynomial hierarchy. Now, inside P, you have a very, very low-level complexity class, which is called bounded depth computation. This is classical bounded depth computation. And this is now zoomed out on the right side in the yellow circle. And inside the bounded depth computation, you have still much more limited computational class, which I refer to as LDP. So this is a computation class that Guy Kindler and I considered. And this refers to a distribution that can be approximated by low degree polynomial. In various aspects, they are much more low level than bounded depth classical computation. And a probability distribution that can be achieved by NISQ systems is belong to this very low level class. So this is this behavior give you one of the major reason why we should not expect NISQ systems to allow a HQCA or quantum supremacy, because NISQ systems are very low level computationally. They are well within classic computations. That computationally speaking, they are classic computing devices. And they are even very primitive classic computing devices. And this is why we cannot expect them to demonstrate a huge computational advantage. There is another aspect of NISQ distribution, of probability distribution for NISQ systems, which also come from the Fourier study. And this is that even if we go below a constant level, for a wide range of sub-constant noise levels, the outcomes will have vanishing correlation with the ideal distribution. Moreover, we can expect that the outcome will present chaotic probability distribution. So we run the same device twice, we will not gain the there will be no stationary probability distribution, underlying probability distribution, and part of the signal will be chaotic. So this is another consequence of the Fourier study of NISQ systems. And so this gives you the following picture of the world of quantum information. When we have a high entropy, we can achieve classical information and computation. And when we reduce the entropy, we get a very primitive computational power, which is described by low degree polynomial. When we reduce the entropy even further, we reach a chaotic regime where we will get a large ingredient of the signal will be chaotic. And theoretically, if we push the entropy even further, we may reach the supremacy or the HQCA regime, but this this low entropy level is beyond, in my view, beyond reach. So I should say that our prediction that a probability distribution coming from NISQ systems are non-stationary and chaotic can be tested by the many NISQ systems that exist today. So for example, here is a test that we did on samples from the Google experiment on 12 qubits. Unfortunately, the Google experiment did not contain sufficiently large samples for more than 14 qubits. And this, I think, is a weakness of their setting. So it's not easy to study the noisy distribution for a larger number of qubits. But for 12 qubits, we can still see something. And also another weakness is that for small number of qubits, they didn't give results for different runs of the system on different occasion. But what we did, we look at their half million sample, and we compared the first quarter million to the last quarter million. And this diagram, maybe I'll not get into much detail, but it shows that it suggests that the distribution is not stationary. The first, although the fidelity did not change, but the distribution itself is distinguishable between the first quarter a million and the last. And I think there is a lot to be studied in this direction for various NISQ systems and NISQ computers. We look forward from data from the IBM quantum computer and from other systems. Okay, so let me move to my next snapshot, which is also a beautiful mathematical story. And this is about permanence and boson sampling. And here I remind you a very important insight in computational complexity. Multiplication is easy, but factoring is hard. This is very relevant to quantum computing because quantum computing by Shor, famous algorithm, can efficiently factor. And another very major insight is that determinants are easy and permanents are hard. So to compute determinants is easy. This is one of the miracles of our world. And this goes back to the work of Gauss. And Gauss elimination. And this is extremely important fact. And permanents are very similar to determinants, but they don't have the minus sign. And they are hard to compute, even by quantum computers. So computing permanent is a whole important complexity class called Sharp P. And as I said, these insights, both about multiplication and factoring and determinants and permanents, are very old, and they were studied before modern computational complexity. And I, I should say quantum computers make factoring easy and also makes permanent somewhat easier. It's not easy to compute permanent even for a quantum computer, but it's easy for a quantum computer to sample according to values of permanent. And we'll come back to this in a minute. But I should mention that in 1913, Polya proposed the following problem. Show that there is no affixing of plus minus sign of the elements of a square matrix, such that the determinant of the resulting matrix equals the permanent of the original matrix. So of course, if there was such a fixing of the signs, then this would have this will show a way to compute permanents efficiently, at least with circuits, with algebraic circuit. But indeed, it was proved very quickly afterward that this indeed correct. And this is sort of an insight, which is a computational complexity insight, much before computational complexity theory was invented. So let me mention what is boson sampling. And boson sampling, I should refer you to the paper by Aronson and Arkhipov from 2010, 2013. And also to an older paper by Trojansky and Tishby from 96. And the computational task is the following. You have a N by M matrix, and you have orthonormal rows, complex matrix, and you sample subsets of the columns with repetition according to the absolute value squared of the permanent. So the repetition, this should come up in some way. I will not get to it. And this task is referred to as boson sampling. And when I talked about bold suggestion to achieve HQCA or quantum supremacy using NISQ system, I think the first bold suggestion was by Aronson and Arkhipov to use to apply boson sampling. And quantum computers, one major insight is that quantum computers can perform boson sampling. So this go back to the paper of Trojansky and Tishby. They thought that this could lead, they studied to what extent this leads to quantum computers being able to compute permanents, but they concluded that it doesn't. And there is a good theoretical argument from A10 that these tasks are beyond, that boson sampling is beyond reach for classical computers. And I should say that boson sampling, it's also very nice that it was introduced. In biology, there is an organism called C. elegans, and this is some sort of a worm that has that a lot of biology can be studied, a lot of issues in biology became much simpler, but still sufficiently complicated for the C. elegans. So there is a huge amount of study around the C. elegans. And in my view, the boson sampling is some sort of the C. elegans of quantum computing. So there are several technical and conceptual aspects of quantum computation and of NISQ systems, which are clearer in this model. For example, my argument, if you want to apply to general quantum systems, you need to have a delicate multi-scale analysis. And this is not necessary for boson sampling. We don't have to worry about a scale, a larger scale that fault tolerance might be possible. Okay, so indeed, about a month ago, a paper in Science appeared which asserted the quantum computational advantage using photon. And this showed indeed a huge advantage. So I'll read you just one part of a sentence. So it yield a state in 10 in a Hilbert space dimension of a space of dimension 10 to the 30, and the sampling rate is 10 to the 14 faster than using state of the art simulation strategy. and supercomputers. And this conclusion is reached by validating, again from the abstract, validating the sample against plausible hypotheses exploiting thermal state, distinguishable photons, and the uniform distribution. Now, a few days afterwards, I point out in a comment in the Shtetl Optimized blog, famous blog, that this is probably wrong, and this is based on my paper with a Guy Kindler. What we showed in that paper is that we can reach a probability distribution with correlation k over n, where n is the number of photons, and for this we need only degree k polynomial time. And so this means this have two consequences. First of all, that the methodology, the derivation from the validation that is described in the abstract to the fantastic conclusion is incorrect. So this we can say right away. And also it suggests a way to give classically samples which will do as good or better than the samples that were obtained by the photonic device. And this will take, I think, a few weeks or perhaps a few months to verify. So I think in this case, the work with Guy Kindler and me give directly shed the very, very serious concerns or doubts on the claims from this paper. Okay, so let me move to other topic. I see I'm going a little bit out of time, but I want to tell you some fascinating mathematical and statistical aspect of the Google experiment. So one part of it is the so-called Porter-Thomas distribution. And here, so by the way, I should have said in advance, if you have questions, you can interrupt me or, and you can send them by chat. Actually, you already got a message to this. For this. So let me tell you a few things about the statistics and mathematics of the Google experiment. So if you have a quantum state of a quantum computer with n qubits, then the state is represented by a unit vector in an m-dimensional complex vector space where m is 2 to the n. And the coordinates of these vectors are referred to as amplitudes. When we measure the state, we get a single sample from a discrete probability distribution where the probabilities are W1 is the absolute value of U1 squared. Sorry, there is a typo here. W2 is the absolute value of U2 squared, and so on. Wm is the absolute value of Um squared. So we get these probabilities that sum up to 1. And when U is a random unit vector, these probabilities are themselves distributed like exponential random variables. Actually, more precisely, it's like Dirichlet variables, because we condition on the sum being one, sum of square being one. And the reason is that the real and complex components of a random vector behave like Gaussian. And when you take, this is something which is useful to know, when you take the sum of squares of two Gaussians, you get an exponential distribution. When you get the sum of squares of k Gaussians, you get a more general, well-known distribution. So now the resulting probability distribution, okay, now, so we have the probabilities, they are the self random variables, And the resulting probability distribution 1 up to m is called a Porter-Thomas distribution. Here are two people that are related to the mathematics, Archimedes and Dirichlet, that are related to the mathematics we mentioned. So I should say that here is from the Google sample, you can see how the theory and the samples agree. So you see an example of Porter-Thomas probabilities. So the Porter-Thomas probabilities, they will correspond to a single sample. And here you see coming from a simulation and coming from the Google experiment. So here is a basic a picture. You have a real distribution, in this case, the exponential distribution. From it, you move. I don't know if you see my.
Yeah, we do. We see our cursor.
So you move from samples of length m. From the continuous distribution, you get a sample. From the sample, you get a new distribution, discrete probability distribution based on the sample. And now you make a new sample of length n, capital N, based on this discrete probability distribution. So this is the basic picture behind a random circuits and the Google model. Also, random circuits, of course, can be run by the IBM computer and so on. So this is the basic picture. And now there are a few things, there are a few twists in the basic picture. It's not a single real distribution, but rather a mixer of two or more. This accounts for the noise. The sample is not a random sample. This is a very important topic. It is a pseudo-random sample, and the pseudo-randomness is realized by the quantum circuit, and this is what's hard to simulate classically. Another addition is that the M entries, they themselves correspond to 0-1 vectors of length n. And now I want to I don't know if I'll have time to all the snapshots, and I want to reach the conclusion of the talk, but I want to mention one very beautiful statistical idea, which is the notion of size bias distribution. So suppose you want to estimate the distribution D of the number of people in apartments. So there are some apartments with one person, some with two, some with three, some with more. So you sample a random person on the street, and you sample random people on the street, ask each one how many people share their apartment. So you will get a distribution of answer. We call it E. Now, the distribution of answer is not identical to the original distribution you look for. And there is a quick way to see it, because in the original distribution, there are apartments that have zero people. And of course, these apartments will not be represented at all in the distribution E. In general, E will give higher weight to higher values. And the E, here I see I have another typo, but E is called the size bias distribution corresponding to D. And we face a similar situation in the Google case. So here I added it to the picture, to my basic picture. From the real distribution, the exponential distribution, you can create also the size bias distribution. And here is a you can see on the same picture the size bias distribution, both the theoretical one and the one obtained from the experiment for 36 qubits. And here you see a very nice fit of the empirical data. And the idea is that if we want to study the size bias distribution, we don't need very large samples. And this is the main statistical idea in the Google experiment. Okay, let me mention one more thing, is that modeling the noise, the way, so I'll do it very quickly, the Google noise model is a mixture between the noiseless distribution, the uniform distribution, and we have some, this model, as I said, the samples in the Google experiment are fairly limited, so we can only study them for 12 qubits or 14 qubits. But one thing we observe is that the Google model does not give a good fit to the data. We had our own improved model based on readout errors, which slightly improved the situation. But still, I can say largely we don't understand the noisy model for the Google experiment. And it's not clear, as I said, that there is a stationary model. And now I want to mention briefly another very nice idea is how to estimate the fidelity in the Google experiment. This can also be implemented, I think, in the new boson sampling experiment. In the boson sampling experiment, they used a slightly different statistical test, but I think this type of test might be better to the extent it can be carried out. I will not go to the test. I'll just explain the crucial statistical philosophy. Once we use numerical simulation to compute the ideal probabilities, we can recover the size bias distribution and estimate the fidelity from relatively small samples. Okay, so let me not go into it, but it's a nice statistical picture. I should say that we studied quite extensively various estimators. We found some slight improvement. Overall, the Google estimator is a good estimator. We slight both alternative estimator, we some improved estimator, and also alternative estimator, which is based on some secondary structure of the signal that we developed. And it's related to the Fourier picture that we discussed. So I want to, well, one thing I will not have time to discuss is consequences for physics from the theory and the argument that quantum computers cannot be achieved. What do we learn about noisy quantum systems and our noisy quantum world in general? And you can read about it in section 5 and 8 in this paper and some other papers. But I want to mention just in 1 minute a nice aspect of our recent study of the new USTC experiment, boson subphotonic experiment, is that we try to consider approximation of the boson sampling distribution that will perform well for the statistical test that were used in this paper. And we discussed this matter, several researchers, including Yelmer Renema. And we discussed very closely related the truncations of the full expansion. One was something that Renema proposed, and it can be described mathematically very simply, but as he mentioned, this is a sort of a truncation of a Feynman diagram expansion. You take the first k terms of a Feynman diagram expansion for the probability distribution. And there is the truncation in my paper with Guy Kindler. And this amounts to further truncating each term of the Feynman diagram expansion. And our expansion represent a very low level complexity. I think in practice, both this truncation can be computed. And I think this connection can be of more general interest. Can we make some similar truncation or approximation like the one I used with Guy Kindler for other a more general manifestation of Feynman diagrams computation. And this seems both very interesting, and I wouldn't be surprised if it's related to connect to existing computing method, effective computing method in computational chemistry and the physics. Okay, what happened? Okay. So let me make an open question. This is related to some work of Yaron Silberberg that I've not mentioned here, but are there applications of the technological advances represented by the Zhu Zhang experiment? Is the new photonic experiment earlier by the Sycamore chip and other superconducting and ion-trapped NISQ system other than computational advantage? So besides computational advantage, there can be other application engineering, scientific application beside the computational advantage, beside proving that quantum computers cannot be reached, there can be some application of this technology, which is quite remarkable technology. And this is especially interesting if my theory is correct, but it's also interesting if my theory is not correct. So let me reach my conclusion. The question if quantum computers are possible is a clear-cut, a scientific question. A negative answer is a serious possibility, and it may shed light on important questions in quantum physics. The massive efforts for HQCA attempts, developing NISQ systems in general, and the quantum computer endeavor represent a remarkable and moving side of the scientific spirit. However, far from being among the notable discoveries of the century, the recent HQCA demonstrations may offer some understanding of the limitations and weaknesses of technology and of scientists. And I can see also a silver lining, a progress in our ability to simulate noisy quantum systems is expected both ways, both if we can build quantum computers, then this will be certainly a major tool for simulating a quantum system, but also if we understand why quantum computers cannot be built, this suggests better ways using classical computer to simulate noisy quantum physics. So let me finish by thanking you very much. Here is pictures of several institutions, centers, and the grant agencies that are related to my work. And I would like to mention I'm very thankful for this grant agencies. And let me mention the several research centers, both the Quantum Information Center and the Center of Study of Rationality in the Hebrew University, and the Center for the Foundation of Cryptography in IDC Herzliya. Okay, so thanks again, and I'm happy to hear some questions.
Right. Thank you very much for this wonderful talk. Howard, are you still there? I'll let you have a go before you run out.
Okay. I just have a question about the Venn diagram, the complexity Venn diagram picture that you put up. Just a clarification. Yep, that's the one. Just a clarification that I mean, what this is showing is what you believe to be the case rather than what has been proven. Would that be fair to say?
Okay, so there are several aspects. On the left side, nothing was proven. We don't know to prove.
No, okay, all right. Okay,
this is what you meant. This is not what you meant.
That's not what I meant. I guess I was specifically talking about the NISQ about the bounded depth computation.
Okay, So here on the right-hand side, I should say the following. The fact that bounded depth computation is smaller than P is a proven fact.
When you say smaller than P, you mean it does not include P?
No, that it's strictly... So bounded depth computation is known to be strictly lower than P.
Okay.
It is known. This is, now, mm-hmm. The fact that NISQ systems can be represented by LDP, the fact that this is the asymptotic behavior, I would say this is a proven fact based on our noise models. So if our noise models it's both a proven and an easy fact based on our noise model. So we proved it for boson sampling with our noise model. And this is very likely to extend to other systems, like to quantum circuits and to other NISQ systems. So this is a proven fact. The fact which is a little bit, and I mentioned it, we apply asymptotic statements to study intermediate scale systems.
Right.
So this
is
a major conceptual issue that needs to be addressed. But this picture on the right describing the fact that asymptotically NISQ systems are described by this picture, right. I would say it's largely proven. It's not proven for every noise model. It's not proven for every NISQ system. But I think there is a very strong theoretical evidence for that.
Okay. And so would you even say is it even controversial even to claim that in an asymptotic, a strict asymptotic sense?
I think it's not controversial. So I think it was important. As I said, there are several things that I mentioned. All these claims are not controversial, but people don't put them together and draw the logical conclusion. I think it's not controversial to think that that NISQ systems with bounded level of noise have very low computational complexity behavior. What might be controversial is to draw conclusion for intermediate scale systems, but this is very common in the way computational complexity applied to practical questions. So we do it all the time. For example, even when we try to apply insight on computational difficulty, we do the same thing. We say we can have some evidence, some theoretical evidence that making this task is asymptotically very difficult. And this supports the claim that for 53 qubits, we have a huge quantum advantage. So this is also a leap of a similar nature. So I hope this answers your question.
Yes, okay, yeah, thank you, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right, thank you. Jonathan, you have a question? You want to unmute yourself?
Thank you for the talk. I just have a question. Are these arguments limited to like building a general purpose quantum computer, or do you foresee them also being applied to like efforts to build a analog quantum simulator? Because in my mind, I would think it should be quite feasible to build that. If I have a specific question, it should be that is maybe classically hard to simulate or calculate on a classical computer. Would it not be feasible to build a custom quantum simulator device, some sort of apparatus, almost like performing that experiment?
Okay, so this is also a very good question. And the argument the argument asserts that you cannot achieve a huge computational advantage. So this you cannot achieve whether you do it with a general purpose or with special purpose. For example, boson sampling is a sort of a special purpose device. So this you cannot achieve. The fact that you cannot achieve it also means that nature does not achieve it. So this means that you don't need to achieve a huge quantum advantage to simulate quantum systems in nature. This is a far-reaching and bold consequence, but this is something we used. Many people used to the idea that since we find something difficult, we we interpret it is that this represents some superior computational ability, but this is not the case. Now, so the conclusion, and this was my last sentence, is that you will be able to find better ways to simulate. So your question is, will it be useful to simulate one quantum system using another quantum system? And here I can, first of all, using one quantum system to simulate another quantum system is something which sometimes have advantages on its own, because when you simulate a state on a classical computer, you don't really create this physical phenomena of entanglement. And so if you want to create physical phenomena in one system that mimic the behavior of another system, then you need to use some physical device. But I don't see any computational advantage for doing it. So you don't need a superior computational power, and you don't get superior computational power using quantum physics. All these quantum physics devices may have a lot of other applications. For example, I mentioned Silverberg's work. He showed how entanglement can improve the accuracy of certain systems. I remember, I think it was maybe MRI, but I think you have to. I think you cannot expect huge advantage in any way. All this huge 10 to the 30 advantages, something which are not realistic, but you can have some advantages and not necessarily computational advantages.
I think we have a 1 minute question from Rahul. Rahul, do you want to ask the question directly?
Okay, yes. So thanks for the talk. So the way I understand is that what you're trying to say is that basically the very small noise levels that we need for fault tolerant quantum computing to build error correcting codes, those noise levels will not be possible in practice, right? Why do you think that such small noise levels are not possible? I mean, are not possible due to the technological limitations, or is there some fundamental reason why they will not be possible? Number one, yeah. And number two, related but a different question, slightly different question, that what do you think are the main issues with the Google experiment, like main limitations or main issues with respect to the conclusions that they are drawing?
Okay, so the Google experiment is a complicated matter, and I gave a colloquium talk in Harvard. There are several papers, you can look there, and then I raised some issues with the Google experiment. But let me go to your first question, which is really the crux of matter. So the issue is that there is a conceptual reason why we cannot reach the noise level that allow quantum error correction. So it's not just a practical, it's a conceptual obstacle. And this conceptual obstacle, as I said, the reason we cannot reach the noise level that allow quantum error correction is because on the way to achieve this low level, we will reach higher a level, which will allow to demonstrate HQCA on NISQ systems. And we have conceptual reason why NISQ systems cannot achieve huge computational advantage. And this is a conceptual reason. And this is a conceptual reason coming from computational complexity. NISQ systems, as we saw in this picture, NISQ systems, they represent a very low level complexity class. So for example, if somebody tell you that he built some analog machine to factor numbers and you figure out that this machine is classical, this gives you a very strong evidence that you cannot tune the machine to factor numbers, although people make such suggestions. So here, the NISQ systems, they are classical devices, and they are even primitive classical devices. And this is the standard way we derive conceptually insights from computational complexity to practical computation, is that low-level complexity devices that represent low-level computation cannot achieve high, very sophisticated computation. So this is not just a practical obstacle. This is a conceptual obstacle.
So by asymptotically, when you say NISQ, you mean constant depth circuits? When you say bounded depth?
When I say NISQ, NISQ refer to intermediate scale. So this refer to number of physical components, which is at most in the hundreds. But even if we talk about...
No, asymptotically, when you say asymptotically.
No. But there is a more delicate point here. Even if we talk about bounded regime between 0 and 500 qubits, we can still use asymptotic analysis. Right. So we do it all the time. And the correct way to do asymptotic analysis is to study asymptotically NISQ systems when the rate, the noise level is constant.
Yeah, I think we have to move on. Sorry about that. You can carry on in the chat anyhow.